Good evening, everyone. I'm sorry we had some technical difficulties tonight. Welcome to Anomalous Realities. I'm really quick going to bring in my co-hosts as we were just having trouble connecting to the studio this evening for some reason. So I'm going to bring in Marky Mint and Melina. And I'm adding them to the call now, so hopefully they'll be with us in just a moment. And there we have Marky. Okay. And Melina, are you with us?
Yes, I am here.
All right. So, ladies and gentlemen, we have had some technical difficulties tonight, but Anomalous Realities is now with you. So I think we're just going to skip our intro music tonight, Mark, because we kind of got, you know, a weird start. Is awfully strange, I have to say. For some reason, we could not bring the studio in earlier, and I don't know. I'm not exactly sure what happened there, but I'm glad we're all here now. So, with that said, good evening, everyone. And Marky, it's been an interesting week for you. So I kind of wanted to open up by talking to you about what you guys have been going through over there in the UK, and you know what the "quote unquote" Brexit means, not just to you guys but to the world, and where you stood on it.
Well, absolutely. It's all been about our referendum over here. I tell you, as I mentioned to you earlier, spiritual issues have kind of taken a bit of it's pushed aside briefly whilst we deal with this issue. As you may or may not be aware, the campaign had been sort of rolling for a good few months now. In the last week, things got a bit strained because we had like a high profile shooting of an MP in the country. And that was, you know, less than a week after you had your tragic incident in Orlando. Right. And that really sort of hushed the campaigns of the referendum up, both of them and the people, I think. And then, yes, of course, the voting happened yesterday, and today it's been, you know, there's been a mix of emotions, of course. It was so closely called. It was 50-50, really. But, I mean, social media has been pretty volatile today, and... you know, a lot of people saying, I'm not British anymore, or I don't want to associate with Britain and stuff, you know, quite extreme views. And we've seen like the markets drop as money does react to things, you know,
right.
As it reacts to things like earthquakes. Of course, it's going to react to this EU decision, but that's picked up again. And, you know, there's a lot of pessimism, some optimism, I think in time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the decision has been made, hasn't it? So got to work with it.
What does that mean for Britain right now? You guys are pulling out of the European Union. What is that going to equivalate to realistically in your real world, in your everyday lives?
In real world terms, in, you know, on the street, I guess that's going to, well, you know, it could affect things in different directions. I mean, it may have an impact on like certain jobs, certain industries. You know, I wouldn't deny that. It just means a new kind of footing, I think. It is undoubtedly a bit of a shake-up. And as someone pointed out to me, in a way, a bit of a fake revolt, maybe. But it's... you know, I mean, I feel personally as if too much of our law is starting to be handed over, you know, decisions to Brussels, and this European super state idea. It is an idea. There is so much good to being part of that, but I think sometimes the right thing is not always the best thing.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like you have to at some point just stand up and say, look, this needs fundamental change in some way. I was always a leaver, and I'm sure people are gonna be pretty angry for that.
Do you think the people that that wanted to stay in, do you think they that was perhaps out of fear that they wanted to stay in, the security maybe that they were, that they felt they had by being in the European Union?
Well, I think they have. I think they have good reasons. I mean, there were plenty of reasons to stay in that I myself could agree with. Of course, it is about stability to a high degree, and I'm sure it goes right down to just core ethics and beliefs of the people. You know, those on that side, the same as it is the people on the other side.
Right.
So it does go deep. I mean,
it's a trade-off, isn't it?
Well, it is a bit.
Yeah. It's a little bit of a trade-off. You know, it makes me wonder. Well, isn't this kind of like the first steps? I mean, we've got the United Nations, you've got the European Union, which are kind of trying to bring multiple countries under one rule. Do you think this is kind of the early experimental brainchilds of perhaps those that are trying to promote the one world government? It's like a test run on a minor scale.
me being me, as you know, aliens and that sort of thing. Well, yes, of course, I would see that side of it. And I tried not, you know, I definitely did not bring that side of it into my decision.
Right.
But of course, for me, it was about how it's affected my business, my small business and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, yes, on the personal interest side, yeah, of course, it's these small elite force with their agenda and their ideas. And we are saying, no, we're going to break free of that. I mean, like I say, it has benefits to jobs and industries and that, but it's still the root issue is the fact that it is this, small elite group's idea of a super state. And we will conform to it. It's like that still seems inevitable, being part of the EU, as great as everything would be. That still seems like what they are working towards. And brazenly doing that.
Yep. I think so. And when I heard about this, I was kind of thinking to myself, this kind of, I think it's the best thing for Britain to leave the Union. Because I know that it feels, you know, there's a lot of security in that, but like we were saying, it kind of leads into that. And in my personal opinion, no one person should have that much power that all of the world is under their influence. And that is the ultimate goal, is to bring the whole world under the rule of one individual. And I think that we have these individuals that are running the show, and you can call them, you know, the Illuminati or the elite or whatever you want to give them a name for. I think they've got many names, and I don't even think the names that we're calling them by are probably what they truly are. But I think that their goal, you know, their ultimate goal is to do these little mini things, you know, the United Nations and that, and we know the Rockefellers are heavily into that, and they're striving towards this with the Bilderberg Group, which they're also highly influencers on, and eventually getting it to where they basically control the entire planet. But I think what their devices are that they're using is they are also the people that are leading us into all the wars that we're into. They are financing all the wars that we're seeing all over the planet. And I think the goal is to bombard the public of all the nations with constant chaos and constant war to the point that we are so fed up with all the death and all the killing that we are just desperate for safety. We're desperate for security, and we are finally willing to accept their solution of a one unified world under one government, which no person should ever have that kind of power. No one person should ever have power over the entire planet. That just is wrong, in my opinion. And we have to, I think we should really be aware of these manipulations when they're happening try to resist as best we can and not fall for these false flag events that are happening. Oh, don't, you know, you get me started on the nightclub thing. And there is a lot of evidence to support that a lot of that was not what it seemed to be. There are videos showing people carrying people away from the nightclub, and then there are some showing people carrying people towards the nightclub from a different area, and then when the cameras aren't on them, they put the person down. So it was just for the cameras that they were holding the people. There's videos of a woman talking about, you know, her son and how upset she is, and she's supposed to be on there on the location. But if you look at her glasses, there are studio monitors reflected in her glasses. So she's actually in front of a green screen. So there's a lot more happening than people realize. And so we can't just blindly nod our head because we're afraid to question things like this. And you know why we're afraid? Because it's a horrible thing. And so if you even dare to question the validity of something so horrible, because it is tragic and it is awful, it's kind of like 9/11 when it first happened. People didn't dare say what they were thinking because, you know, it's so awful that it's almost like, you know, just a taboo thing to even consider the fact that this could have been set up to put laws in place, to put controls in place. Now, personally, on the gun control thing, I don't think that people should have assault weapons in their possession. However, I don't think that the United States, what I'm worried about and what most people are worried about is not them taking away the ability for people to have assault rifles on a personal basis, but just a basic ability to defend themselves, because we've seen these camps going up all over the place and we've seen Walmarts being converted with security around them and things. And it looks like they're trying to set up so that we can't resist if they want to initiate a police state. And that is what people are worried about. And that is why the rest of the world doesn't understand why we're worried about our gun control. But those of us at sea can see that our government is very corrupt and very manipulative. And we are worried that if they take away our guns, they're going to try to anybody that resists, like myself, for instance, because I won't just stand there and just nod my head and say, okay, take away all of our rights, take away all of our freedoms. They're going to round us up and they'll be able to do it because we won't have anything to defend ourselves with. This is what the rest of the world doesn't understand about the United States. And they don't understand about why, you know, we are a little bit hesitant about the gun control that they propose, because it's the first step in disarming the population as a whole to weaken us and to make it so that we can't resist if they decide to keep pushing in the wrong directions, because we have been losing our freedoms more and more and more and more every year. This has been going on since a long, long time, but really, really the 2000s when Bush Jr. got in, that was really kind of when things really started going downhill with the Patriot Act and everything else coming in. Then we had the NDAA under Obama, and it just has gotten out of control. Melina, what are your thoughts on this?
Oh, well, I agree. Since Bush and the Patriot Act, there's just been a slow erosion of our freedoms. And mm-hmm. really where they hit us the hardest is listening in. You know, they really,
yeah.
I don't use a lot of social media because that it's completely open for the whole world to see. It's a public thing.
Right.
And so a lot of our privacy rights are completely just ran over and totally obliterated.
Yeah, you know, right? I can't let fear rule me though. I haven't stopped using media, and I don't hold back on my thoughts either, because you know the thing is they're either going to do what they're going to do or they're not. There's not a lot you can do. You can't hide your thoughts. But I personally, I don't do anything wrong. You know, I'm not a bad person. So I'm not afraid of them. So I don't worry about it a whole lot. But in the same token, it's still wrong. It's still a violation of our rights. It's still a violation of privacy. And it's still essentially, you know, against our Constitution. A lot of things that have been going on lately are just completely unconstitutional. And I have a hard time understanding how these things are put through when they go against the basic law of the land that you know, was established after they basically murdered and annihilated all of my people to take over. So they set up a new country and they put down these laws, and now they're violating them. So, which isn't, for any native, it's not a big surprise, you know, but with all of that aside, we are currently living in what we perceive to be a democracy, we believe we have freedom, and we do have limited freedoms, but we don't have the freedom that we believe we have or that most people are told they have. And so I think they're worried that there's going to come a point where people are going to stop just sitting back and letting them take away their freedoms, and they're preparing for that. And that's why they're doing this, in my personal opinion, is because they don't want people taking back their power, because it does, again, lead back to that one world government idea that they're trying to work towards. And they can't do it if there are citizens who are empowered and have the ability to say, no, we don't agree with you. And no, we're not going to take it, you know, and no, we're not going to let you keep doing this. You know, we say no. We're supposed to be able to say no. We're supposed to have the ability to choose the leaders that we want. But we're seeing with Hillary Clinton's campaign that that's not really the case, because her voting polls were set up, and it looks like Bernie Sanders really doesn't have a chance anymore, even though he really has the popular vote. But then we saw this with Bush and Gore, where Gore actually had the popular vote of the people, but Bush still won.
Exactly. Where does it end?
I don't know that it ends.
Well, we have the similar thing with Brexit. I was just reading an article on sort of 8 things that may have influenced Brexit. And, you know, you read some of them and they're seeds that have been sown for many years. Like in Britain, you know, over the past sort of 5 years, more and more families are having to use food banks to get food, you know.
Yeah.
And that's an austerity, things like that. I mean, that will have influenced it in a way here,
right?
Because these have been issues that, like you say, they just keep going and going and going. Mm-hmm. And where do you finally put your foot down and say, well, look, a new direction is needed. I know you maybe you'd prefer something stronger, like you are Illuminati, get out. But,
well, no. I mean, like I said, I mean, I don't think they actually have the names that we give them. It's just, I think it's something that we can use to label those people that are behind it, because it's what we have. It's pretty much all we have to refer to them by. So it's simple.
Yeah. And so surely, like with people like Hillary Clinton and that, I mean, you must have years and years and years of you know, opinions and problems and the opposite of that, things that you've seen that are good. But where does it stop? Where does it end? When will
I think there has to be a massive awakening on a global scale, honestly, to put an end to it, because a lot of it has to do with the fluoride that's in our water, the chemicals that are getting put into our food and in our bodies, the GMOs that are getting banned in every country except our country. I mean, every country is saying, you know, this is toxic and we're not going to give it to our people and it's not allowed here except for our country. Our country takes these lords of poison and puts them up on a pedestal like they're benevolent, you know, gods that are feeding the public, you know, harmonious nutrition that we should be thankful for. And it's the opposite of what the case is. And it doesn't make any sense. But it's a part of that plan. It's a part of that system set up to keep people from resisting what they're trying to do. Like the fluoride in the water was used in the Nazi camps to keep the people docile. The fluoride's now being used to keep us docile. They also tried lithium, and I think in some places it's still being used in the water supplies. I mean, it's just, it never ends. Back in the 1940s, I think it was, Melina, I don't know if you know this exact, but they put, was it LSD? They put a drug in the San Francisco water supply. They basically tested on the people of the United States. The government did this without their knowledge, and it was found out 50 years later after it was declassified under the Freedom of Information Act. But nobody would have ever suspected this was being done to us by our government, but it was. And what was their reasonings for it? It's always been control. The different things that they've tried to do, the MK Ultra, the mind control, that they're constantly trying to find more ways to control us, to keep us, you know, under their thumb, under their rule. And you know, the thing is I really don't even understand the mentality. What is the ultimate goal? What do they gain by having control over everyone? I mean, at the end of the day, what does that do for them? I don't get it. I can't even understand a mentality like that. I honestly can't.
Well, do you have the phone number? Maybe someone out there can tell us.
That's a good point.
Answer the question of what do these people want?
What do they want? That's yes. So yeah, listeners out there, if you want to call us, and on Skype, you can call us. You can call us on Skype by calling Freedom Screen 2. And if you want to call in on a regular phone or a landline, it's 310-421-4053. I would love to hear your thoughts on this. Kind of going into that whole Illuminati thing, we actually had a couple of stories that we were going to be talking about tonight on that subject. And I'm actually leading into this with what would seem to be unrelated, but it's actually the death of a young actor very recently, Anton Yelchin, who most people know as not Scotty, but Chekhov on the newer Star Trek movies and films. Now, personally for me, I was really stunned that he died because he was only 27 years old, but that wasn't the reason why. The reason why it hit me so hard was because before the details had even been released, as a shaman, I had this intuitive feeling that this young man was taken before he was meant to be taken. And we have a caller calling in, so I'm going to add him in. Patrick is actually calling. But I felt like this young man was taken before he was actually meant to be, you know, taken. He had a greater purpose, but he was taken before, which is why I felt he was killed. Patrick, welcome to the show. I would love to hear your thoughts.
Well, it was just something that I heard you mention, and I wrote mm-hmm. you something in chat about it.
Okay.
Okay. And it has to do with this whole quote unquote assault rifle situation.
Yes.
I'm not sure what they mean by assault rifle. That, I think, is an invented trigger word. And so, actually, the problem is, I can't take that call, Stephen. If I answer that call, I'll start two calls.
Yeah.
The problem is this. There is no such thing. It's either fully automatic or it's semi-automatic. And even the AR-15 is semi-automatic. That is just like my Ruger 10/22 or any other, if a little automatic, semi-automatic 45 or 22, whatever. You get one trigger pull, one shot, period. Mm-hmm. Okay? We have not, otherwise, it's a fully auto, a.k.a. machine gun, where you pull mm-hmm. the trigger and you spray bullets. The public has not been able to buy those for going on 50 years now.
That's what I thought. So I was wondering, you know, what the deal was with this. And
yeah, I think it's just they make up the word and they make up the situation so as to make up a totally false problem that then needs solving. And that's what they're up to, because there's nothing new in guns, really.
Right.
That's all I wanted to call in and say.
Well, see, and that was my understanding, too. And so now the rest of the world thinks that, you know, you can go out and you can buy a machine gun, an Uzi, just, you know, off the street. You know, people can just walk up into a gun store and say, hey, I want a machine gun. Give me a, you know, AK-47 or something. And they get it, you know.
Let me make the distinction there. Yeah, you can. If you go in the right part, the bad part of town, you can probably buy bombs.
Yeah, but I mean legally.
Yeah, right. No, legally, we have not, for going on 50 years, been able to buy anything like that.
That's what I thought.
So this is nothing new. So why they're continually pushing on this is stupidity. And all it really does, it's not gun control, it's defense control. They want us to not be able to defend ourselves.
That's exactly.
The problem.
That's exactly what I was saying. Yeah.
They would take our baseball bats from us if that's what we were using, or our bows and arrows and swords, because they took our guns. But they just don't want us to fight back. And that's a non-starter. It ain't going to happen. We will fight back. Try us. And so that, I will go. I just wanted to clear that up because it's a common misconception. Yeah. And Nighthawk even got on the station a couple weeks ago and was talking about that. And no, there's no such thing as an assault rifle you can buy, because I don't even know what.
But they've been leading the public to believe that.
Of course they have. That's what they want.
Yeah.
Yeah. But
that's no surprise there.
Right. In truth, no, it doesn't exist. And not for us. We can't go buy one in the store. So I will go. I just wanted to put in my two cents, and I wish you a good show.
Well, thank you, Patrick. I appreciate that.
You're very welcome.
Thank you for joining us.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Okay, so going back to Anton Yelchin, I felt immediately when I heard about this young man's passing, a deep sadness. Which is uncharacteristic, but I get that when certain souls that are just immensely full of light pass away, like when Princess Diana passed away. I didn't know much about her. You know, it wasn't like, you know, I'm British. She wasn't part of my royal family, but I could not stop crying that night. I could not stop crying when I heard that she had passed away. And I actually feel like there is a connection between the death of this young man and her, in that I think both of them were, they were sacrifices. And I have a friend who told me as much, and this person who told me this, and I cannot divulge who they are, but they are a person who knows a great deal about what goes on in I don't know, high-ranking areas, places, things like that in the UK. I can't really say much more than that, but I do trust what this person told me. And they told me that her death was a sacrifice to the goddess Diana, and that the place where her car crashed was actually above what used to be a not an altar, but I guess to that extent, an old pagan altar to the goddess. So it was a sacrifice, a ritual type of death. It was staged. I felt like this was not right when I heard about this young man's death. It felt like he had a greater purpose, and he was not meant to be taken from this life this early. And then when you find out the details of this freak accident, none of it makes any sense whatsoever. Apparently, he parked his car in his driveway and went to check his mail. And his car pinned him between his mailbox and the car itself, which apparently his mailbox pillar was attached to a security gate, is what they say. Now, the law enforcement, and the press didn't say this because they don't want you to know this, but the law enforcement said that the engine was still running when the body was discovered. They say the car was in neutral. Now, why would somebody put their car in neutral on a steep incline right up from the place that they're going, and then just leave their car in neutral, walk out, and go stand somewhere where the car is going to back into them? When you hear it or you see it start backing, why not get out of the way? None of it makes any sense. It's absolutely ludicrous that he just decided to get out of his car, didn't put it in park, left it in neutral on a hill, and then walked behind it to get his mail and let it crush him and pin him to death. Does that make a bit of sense?
That's odd, but there is another detail. Did you know this detail? That unfortunately, and I agree, just to add that I agree that he seemed like he had an untimely death. But did you read that he also owned like one of the only makes that had been recalled in recent times because it was rolling back on people elsewhere?
Really?
The car he had a specific recall on it because it had come off of its handbrake or whatever it did in various other incidents. Luckily, no one else was killed.
Interesting.
He had a faulty model, but you're absolutely right. I saw a photo of his driveway and it looked like a pretty steep slope.
Yeah. Why would you not put it into park all the way? Why would you even just leave it in neutral unless it shifted by itself into neutral? It doesn't add up.
Yeah.
I mean, he obviously knew, you know, the steepness of the hill. He lived there. I have a hill in my driveway. I would never do that. I would never, ever do that. I don't know. That just doesn't make any sense. It's crazy. But this puts him among many other people who have died young. Jimi Hendrix died at 27, Janis Joplin, Jim Morrison. And of course, they're all, you know, members of what has been come to known as the 27 Club. So I found this article that links the 27 Club to the Illuminati, which we've been talking about tonight. Talks about, you know, the various different celebrities who have died at 27 years over this, you know, last century. And it's been argued that these are ritual killings. Now, I saw somebody who actually said that this was a part of a solstice ritual. However, this did happen before the solstice, technically. So I don't know if that, do you think that could be classified in the solstice? Because I believe it was Sunday when he passed away.
It's pretty close.
It's close, but it's not.
It wasn't.
Could it be? It wasn't on the solstice. It was near it. It was near it. But I don't know if I don't know if you could call that a solstice ritual killing or not, but it certainly was very close to it. I don't know about that. But it just, there have been a great deal. Well, go ahead.
No, I do you remember last week? No, it wasn't last week. I think I only said one thing last week. The week before that, I mentioned how it just seems there's this couple of weeks in the year where everything just goes to crap. Or it's just a heightened.
Yeah.
Whether it's the summer or something. And you're right. It does happen around this period, around the solstice period.
Yeah.
And I think often you have to look at, you can't just say, a specific day. That's giving yourself a very small time frame. But if you look at a period, say a few weeks or something, definitely I think it comes together like that.
Yeah.
Not into a specific day. That's too short a time frame, I think. But definitely a period. And this is definitely it. I mean, look, it's just manic.
Mm-hmm. I agree. So there's a lot of people that believe that 27 has like a numerical significance symbolically, I guess, and ritually. 27 is a perfect cube. 3 × 3 × 3. There are 27 straight lines in a smooth cubic surface, apparently. In religion, philosophy, and the occult, the number 27 has lots of meanings. The Greek strong number G27 is agapetos, apparently, which means beloved. As found in the New Testament of the Bible, it also relates to the love of the beloved to give their life for their master. The number 27 represents the highest level of knowledge in Buddhism. So those who take their oath to the master have gained all knowledge of the world and how it's controlled. It's interesting. The fallen angels mock God by using 27 as the age because it represents the whole New Testament's books, which are 27 books. So this article is actually trying to make a connection between, I think, Satanism or Luciferianism and the number 27, which they in turn will connect to the Illuminati because it's strongly believed that the Illuminati are Satanists. I don't know if I believe that's the case 100%, but I have seen evidence to support it. Although in some cases I've seen coverages of like satanic groups and rituals, and then they'll call it Illuminati, but it doesn't actually have any ties to Illuminati. They're basically calling it Illuminati only because it has satanic ritual involved in it. So I don't know if that connection is actually valid or not, but it's something that is considered. It's something that's been brought forward. In the Kabbalah, there are 27 letters corresponding to 27 channels of communication with God, 27 combinations of the names of God. Another example, basically, is that Satan is responsible for it, according to the article. According to feng shui, to raise money, keep in the house of 27 identical coins, and that equals wealth. Apparently, 27 equals wealth in feng shui. In ancient Incan culture, there were 27 roads to El Dorado and 27 roads to destruction. I wonder what the correlation is there. almost makes you wonder if El Dorado wasn't considered destruction. If there's 27 roads to El Dorado and 27 roads to destruction, that's an interesting correlation. why do some people die at 27? Why do so many famous people die at 27? You know, is it a sacrifice, or is it that these people had a contract and it was up when they're 27? That's one of those things that I don't think we're ever going to fully understand unless people are actually on the inside of one of these secret societies. I'm sure they understand fully well. I'm sure people that are involved with the groups that are associated with the deaths know full well what the correlation is. But I think for us, there's nothing really that we can know other than that there are a lot of correlations between the number 27 and significance with religion, especially symbolic religious associations. So, the 27 Club is definitely one of those things that seem to be associated with, I guess, the Illuminati in some people's estimation, and Luciferianism. Another thing, actually, when I'm thinking about it, there was somebody that made a correlation between his name, Anton Yelchin, and the reason he was sacrificed, because his name is Anton, because the head of the Satanic Church was Anton LaVey. And so they're making that correlation there. What are your thoughts on that, Melina?
Well, I think that's a big stretch that he was chosen because
of his name.
Of his name, yeah. But it is curious that all of these actors and actresses we lose at the age of 27. You know, and it's one of those unusual things that I'm not, just like you said, maybe they understand it perfectly from in a position of knowing, but I can't make heads or tails of it or sense of it whatsoever.
It's unusual.
Yes.
So now, in an seemingly unrelated story, something I wanted to touch on tonight was that there has been apparently a lot of physicians that have confessed to intentionally diagnosing healthy people with cancer to make money. This is something that I think we have suspected in the conspiracy community for a long time, and we've known. But, you know, I don't even know how necessary it is, considering how many people legitimately get cancer because of all the chemicals that they put into everything, especially anything that's convenient. Which, I mean, our lifestyle is kind of circled around convenience now. But apparently there are a great number of doctors. There's Dr. Farid Fatah, a prominent cancer doctor in Michigan, who admitted in court a year ago to intentionally and wrongfully diagnosing healthy people with cancer. He also admitted to giving them chemotherapy drugs for the purpose of making profit. This is just awful.
That's criminal.
It is criminal, and I hope these people are actually being brought up on charges, because they should be. Many of these unscrupulous physicians are like businessmen without a conscience. The only difference is they have your health and trust in their hands, a very dangerous combination where money's involved. Fada said it was his choice. and he actually made a guilty plea, which included rattling off the names of numerous drugs that he had prescribed for his patients over the years. In each admission, he uttered the words, "I knew that this was medically unnecessary." He was charged with running a $35 million medical fraud scheme that involved billing the government for medically unnecessary oncology and hematology treatments. The government says Fada ran the scheme from 2009 to present and through his medical businesses, including Michigan Hematology Oncology Centers with offices in Clarkston, Bloomfield Hills, Lapeer, and Sterling Heights, Troy and Oak Park. Wow, he had a lot of connections. According to the government, Fada had a patient load of 1,200 people and received $62 million from Medicare. He billed for more than $150 million. God, this guy is just a crook. I mean, that's just awful, awful. So I'm reading lower to see. I don't see... I see them talking about others, but I don't see the actual names of others that have done this. So they're actually, I hate articles that do this. They're making a claim, but they've actually only got proof of one. So I don't like that. And shame on you.
What is it, MSN?
No, it's called healinglifeisnatural.com. So, I mean, yes, they had real info, but they sensationalized it. Clickbait, clickbait, clickbait. I can't stand clickbait.
There was, I think it was a German doctor maybe this week that, you know, has been
also
accused.
Also admitted?
Yeah, of like, not necessarily.
Oh,
cancer,
he was accused of it.
Well, no, they found proof that he's had, in his time as doctor, you know, murdered a good bunch of people.
Oh, my goodness.
And that's only come out to light this week, but I didn't quite catch all of that. So, this website, you know, longnames.com, you know, there's probably still some truth behind it.
There's actually another website out there that can also, it will let you know if your doctor's taking money from drug companies, and if so, how much they get from drug companies a year. So that people know, you know, when they're being prescribed medicine, whether or not their doctor was influenced, which is interesting.
Yeah, a kind of rate your doctor thing.
Mm-hmm.
We do have something like that. I think we've got a system a bit like that.
I plan on getting a list of links up on the site to reference people for different topics that we've talked about on the shows. And that'll be coming up. For those of you that haven't been to the site, it's anomalousrealities.com, and it's in a transitional stage right now. It's been completely redesigned, but I want to make sure that it has a lot more information on it than just what our guests are, what our guests are coming up, what our topics are. I want to actually provide some links to the stories that we're talking about so that our listeners can do the research themselves also and follow up and see what information is out there. So that will be going up on the website as soon as I can. But I'm awful, awful busy. And I put as much time into the website as I possibly can. But I'll probably need to get some help on that one of these days because I'm just awfully, awfully, awfully busy.
It's good. It's good.
It's a good thing to be busy, but it also prevents me from doing all the things that I want to do. So in a related story to what we were just talking about, how, you know, there are some doctors that are claiming, you know, they're actually confessing to misdiagnosing people with cancer and giving them drugs that they don't need so they can get rich off of it. On the alternate side of the scale, nearly 50 holistic doctors have been found dead within the past year. That's a lot of people.
That so, is a whole lot of people for yes. there not to be an uproar about it. And well, you hardly hear anything about it.
You know, people don't talk about holistic doctors that much. And that's kind of going to contribute to it. I mean, when there's fewer and fewer of them, you know, I mean, the less doctors there are, the less they're going to be for people to talk about if they all just disappear. It's interesting. I think, who would you think would be behind the death of 50 different holistic doctors? Who has the most to gain from these people dying?
The pharmaceutical companies.
Exactly. And these people have so much money and they want to keep all of that money. So what do they want? They want people to not have other options. They don't want people to treat their diseases naturally because obviously they would lose money and they would go out of business if people actually realized that there were natural ways to take care of the various illnesses that they have. And actually, in a lot of cases, realize that the pharmaceuticals that they're already taking are causing a lot of their illnesses. It's insane, but that number is just huge. Let's see. I'm looking for some names. Let's see. Dr. Jeff Bradstreet, a renowned autism researcher from Florida, was found with a gunshot wound to his chest on June 19th, according to police. The gunshot wound was self-inflicted, therefore the death was ruled a suicide. His family suspects foul play. Only days later, Dr. Bruce Hendedahl, DC PhD of the Miami area, was found slumped over in his car with no indication as to what caused his death. Details regarding his death are even cloudier than that of Bradstreet's, as those who knew him report he was extremely fit and healthy. In fact, he had been doing an athletic event earlier in the day before he was found dead. On the same day as Dr. Hedinal's body was found, Dr. Baron Holt, D.C., was also found deceased in Florida. The physician unexpectedly died while on a trip to Jacksonville. Let's see. They had three dead in the same field in a very short period of time. And this is just a single article about them. June 26th, Dr. Patrick Fitzpatrick, M.D., goes missing. He was traveling from North Dakota to Montana, which he did very frequently, and his truck and trailer were found on the side of the road. Apparently, he vanished without a trace. Jeff Whiteside, MD, a pulmonologist, went missing when he simply walked away. Dr. Whiteside is known for his successful treatment of lung cancer. He disappeared in Door County, Wisconsin. Oh, interesting. While vacationing with family. They say he was on foot and had no vehicle, and numerous reports call it mysterious, saying he vanished without a trace also. They've been searching now for 2 weeks, and even colleagues have joined in, but not a shred of evidence in those 2 weeks. Wow.
Spooky.
It is. It's scary is what it is. Nearly 50 doctors have died and gone missing under mysterious circumstances. This riveting finding has resulted in some exposure on the topic, including articles by the New York Times, The Independent, UK, and network affiliates such as ABC, CBS, NBC, and Fox. But the whole story, or many threads connecting to the various murders, is not being told. For this reason, the activist took on the internet on the one-year anniversary of the first of the mysterious deaths to express how serious of a concern these events are. Wow. So it seems pretty obvious to me right now that natural medicine is under attack. I mean, in a very real way. I mean, this is murder. There's no two ways about it. These people are being murdered. There's no coincidences that great that 50 holistic or nearly 50 holistic doctors either vanish completely without a trace or just pop up dead for seemingly unexplained causes or suicide. Very, very, very suspect. And I really don't know how they keep getting away with this other than the fact that they can pay it off. I mean, they've got so much money. They just pay off law enforcement and they pay off whoever they've got to pay off so that they can keep doing what they're doing and keep dumbing down our country and keep poisoning our country and the world for that matter. I mean, the pharmaceutical companies aren't limited to the United States by any means. So this is a massive problem we have. I mean, huge. And what do we do about it?
Well, it is scary. I will give you that. 50 yeah. people, you say. The last person is just missing, though, aren't they?
They vanished without a trace. Yeah, but there's vanished. They're like they say, mysterious vanishings, because they have no way. There's no evidence. And
none of these were witnessed. And like you said, the other people, no one witnessed them. Like,
apparently sort of
being
not.
Killed or
no, no.
Very odd.
Mm-hmm. Very odd indeed. And it looks like we are out of time for the first hour, so we'll be going to break in a couple of minutes. We will be back with some. A little bit more anomalous stories when we return from the break. So that will be. And in the meantime, if anybody wants to call in with any comments or things during the second half of the hour, once again, our number for the show is 310-421-4053. And if you want to call in on Skype, it is Freedom Screen 2. We'll see you guys back in 5 minutes. Welcome back, everyone, and we are going into hour two. Real quick, before we go back into the show, I just want to take a minute to remind everyone that we are sponsored by Revolution Radio at www.freedomslips.com, and this station is 100% user-supported. So if you like what you're hearing, if you're enjoying the show, just take a minute and go to the website, and there is a support button on there, and just hit on that and give whatever you can. Because without generous donations from listeners like you, when you tune in, there'll be nothing but silence. So we need you as much as you need us. We try to bring you important information, things that we feel, you know, are important for people to hear, things that you won't hear just about anywhere else. So we're here for you, and we ask that you be here for us. And it's just that simple. So we're back. Marky, are you back with us?
Yes.
All right. Excellent. Okay. And Melina, are you with us?
I am here.
All right. So we're coming back with an interesting story I came across. Apparently, in 2017, there is a mysterious object that will be passing the Earth. Now, this thing has got scientists scratching their heads because it is behaving very unusually. The continued speed of this object doesn't make sense. It continues to move at a varying speed, meaning that it accelerates and decelerates gradually. Now, I don't know of any other object in space that speeds up and slows down. Natural laws of physics, you know, unless you have some other force acting against it, would prohibit it from behaving this way. The object was discovered in early November of 1991 by an astronomer named James Scotty of the University of Arizona. There are countless celestial objects that are being tracked and discovered every day by astronomers. However, this particular object had enough irregularities for the scientific community to take note of it. The object is referred to as 1991 VN, is a mere 10 meters in diameter, so it's fairly small, has a heliocentric orbit spin past the edge of the Milky Way. But what's unusual about it, and there should be lots of similar objects, why must it be of alien origin is the question, because this object could belong to an advanced civilization. That's what people are starting to actually consider. That's what scientists are actually starting to consider, is because of its strange behavior. And apparently there are several other strange features connected with 1991 VN. The mystery object, it has this heliocentric orbit. However, objects in space with a diameter similar to that do not normally behave like this. What's even stranger is that the continued speed doesn't make sense either, as it continues to move at varying speeds. So it speeds up and slows down. And there's actually even more mystery. After researchers had predicted the initial orbit of the object, scientists realized that in the object, it flew past the Earth in 1975. Scientists concluded that the varying increments of time were extremely anomalous and unlike any natural object previously seen in our galaxy. Researchers concluded that the object had a strange high rotational spin. Its brightness varies over time. Many believe that the greatest mystery behind 1991 VN is the luminescence variance. All of the anomalies combined make it extremely difficult for researchers to identify the nature of the object. I can tell you the nature of the object. Scientists are unable to agree on a single theory that would shed light onto this mystery object, or at least explain it away. Among the numerous theories, and due to the uncertainty of the object's origin, combined with various anomalies in the object's brightness in images that have been attained during its passage near Earth in 1991, some have speculated that 1991 VN could be a spent rocket fuel tank or a rocket body from a satellite launched during the 1970s or from an Apollo mission. None of the previously mentioned, however, seems to explain the additional anomalies of the object. While at this point the object could be anything, the most popular theory, surprisingly, is aliens, right? Among the many theories that are proposed, there is a possibility that the mysterious object is, in fact, an extraterrestrial probe or ship. The article says probe. I'm saying ship, okay? I'm saying ship.
Because a probe would still go at a constant speed, wouldn't it?
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, this thing is speeding up and slowing down, which means it's being controlled and it's like maneuvering. You know, it's adjusting. This is the type of thing that you would have with a manned vehicle. If you know, it just doesn't make sense. Space objects don't behave like that unless it is intelligently controlled. But yeah, the article goes on to say that they believe it to be an alien probe observed in the vicinity of our planet. I mean, I suppose it could be a probe. But it just doesn't behave like a probe. I think perhaps some of the reason that they think it's a probe is because it goes by occasionally. I don't know.
Well, yeah. Well, this is it. And at the end of the article, they mentioned that thing where mathematicians say that statistically speaking, there probably has to be this sort of thing out there or even right. in our solar system right now.
Mm-hmm.
The odds are just too high. But the best part of this, of course, and I hadn't heard of it until you mentioned it, is that it will pass us next year. So
right.
its identity is inevitable.
Yeah, I wonder how close it's going to pass when it passes is what that's kind of what I'm wondering, is how close it's going to get to us. If this object does the speeding up and the slowing down, as they say, and this is probably a controlled object, will we get a visit? You know, will this be something that, you know, our governments won't be able to stop us from seeing? You know, I know this is what Reagan wanted to do with the Star Wars program all those years ago. You know, there's a reason he wanted that program. There's a reason he was paranoid. I know not all the civilizations that visit us are benevolent. Obviously, there's got to be a reason that they want to have protection. But some of them are. I firmly believe that some of them are. And I don't believe that we can possibly know how many are in contact with us. You know, if it's one or it's, you know, a dozen or, you know, several hundred, I don't think we could possibly know that, because we might have an idea of how many, you know, are verified that have made contact, but that doesn't even really tell us how many are actually around that we're not even aware of, because they're very subtle or they're invisible to the human eye, can't be detected. I think we are so limited as human beings in what we perceive, you know, to be extraterrestrial contact and what our ideas are of, you know, what life might be like outside of our planet. Because it's actually starting to be proven that life exists in space itself. that there are life forms that can actually exist in space, in the void of space. If that's the case, you know, there are so many other things that we don't even take into consideration. It might not even be something you could physically see. It could be a form of energy. I think this is why so many people who think outside of the box really connect so well to Star Trek and the whole series of Star Trek, because they really attack the idea of out-of-the-box thinking when it came to beings that were not from our planet. At least the early series did. And Next Generation kind of did a little bit too. But then they kind of got kind of in the whole humanoid thing, like tends to happen over time, and they strayed from some of the more creative things. But there were still, even in the films, there were still some very creative things. I think that's what we really need to take into consideration, is we need to start looking at this from a perspective of the fact that we may not even be able to perceive an extraterrestrial intelligence if it was in contact with us or around us or on the planet, because we might not have the ability to perceive it even when it's right near us. That's something we need to think about. So we think that, you know, some people think they've never seen it, or they've never, you know, it could never be even be around them. There could be entities that are living in harmony with us right now on the planet that may even be terrestrial to our planet, but that we aren't even aware of because we are limited in our senses. We are limited in our vision spectrum, in our, we only can see and perceive what our senses allow us to. And unfortunately, although we don't like to see it that way, our senses are pretty limited. What are your thoughts on this, Marky?
Well, yeah. What was I going to say? The unexplained as a whole, mm-hmm. How do we know that that isn't an entity? You know, this thing that you can't touch and you can't see.
That's a good point.
But it is something, isn't it?
It is.
And it manifests in its own way that we don't understand. Mm-hmm. And I think that might give us a good impression of like sort of alien interaction, if there mm-hmm. were to be that. It could be this level that is... to us, it's just a feeling or something. But you probably understand what I mean by that. I don't think I can explain it much
better than that. Melina, I would really love to hear your thoughts on this too.
Well, I think that you're right. We don't even know if we would be able to recognize an alien life form in front of us if it was even there. Mm-hmm. And, you know, from what we hear from abduction stories and stuff like that, there seems to be an interdimensional proponent to it anyways, that even expands it even further as to how long they could have coexisted next to us. We could be talking about a millennium old type of visitation, and they've always been here mm-hmm. next to us, and you know, this might not even be something new.
Well, that's the thing, we have like UFO flaps and stuff like that, don't we? I mean, they're moments in time where all that sort of stuff seems to feel very close to us and mm-hmm. very relevant. And I don't know how you feel about it, but sort of the last few years, that sort of thing, like the aliens and UFOs and that, has sort of been a bit, just not much of it at all, really. Nothing significant. But it looks like, with this story you just read, that it is coming back round again, because posted around the same time as your article, there is something else about a Kickstarter, which they funded $100,000 to investigate KIC 8462, which is a bit more of a mouthful than 1991 VN.
Yeah.
But this is like a star that they're quite certain does have the answers, or some answers, as to whether it is producing like artificial alien energy or something or not. And mm-hmm. you know, they've funded it to use a telescope to gather the data. So my point there was that this and that object you mentioned decreasing and increasing speed, mm-hmm. it looks like we're maybe in line for some quite spectacular discoveries.
Yeah.
And that could possibly be the next UFO sort of flat phase or whatever, where everything's like, but we haven't really been in that level of mind, I don't think.
I think things have been suppressed a little bit more lately because the people have increased the interest. So I think the efforts to make every sighting appear to be, you know, a fake, you know, some sort of hoax, I think is been ramped up very strongly. I actually had a story that I was going to get to if we had time, but since we're kind of going into this area, I'm gonna grab it real quick. The most recent alien encounter, and this comes from EarthWeareOne.com. The most recent alien encounter took place on May 20th, 2016, in a residential area of El Dorado in Santa Cruz, Bolivia, around 10 p.m. A great number of residents and passing by students witnessed a UFO at close range circling in the sky. Following the event, the UFO somehow crashed in the call number 2 of the district. One of the locals reported that before the crash happened, a bright light surged from the sky, finally leading to what would be next an unforgettable experience. Moments before the fall of an alien being, the UFO made quite the entry with a blinding display of lights and deafening outburst-like noise, inducing a state of panic among all the people, causing the people in the radius of the site to run out of their homes, rush out, and to find out what the cause of all the commotion was. One of the witnesses claimed that he had captured it on camera the moment when it roamed over the area. And soon after the circling, an extraterrestrial being emerged from the UFO as if it jumped off or fell by mistake. Nobody knows for sure. A quote, "It all began with a bright light in the sky when the unimaginable occurred," one of the locals reported. "Something came down, straight down. A light came straight down, more or less, and they say it lost itself in that tree. I tried to get into the house over there." Or it tried to get into the house. So this creature, this alien being that came out of the craft, tried to get into somebody's house.
It fell out of the spaceship and then tried to like call 911 or something.
I don't know. It sounds so strange, but apparently a lot of people saw it. The first sight of the confused civilians was the alien astronaut just as he fell and landed from the UFO. Then the being seemed in a state of panic and tried to escape the eyes of the people that were watching it. According to 3 school children, after he landed on the ground, the extraterrestrial tried to flee as quickly as possible from the curious crowd, heading to hide from the eyes of the residents into a random house. The statement stunned a number of adult residents that were in the vicinity of the scene. So it was the kids that saw it originally. Moreover, these 3 kids traced the path of the alien that he took after his fall, pointing to several locations around the neighborhood, including a tree it was seen climbing up in order to get back to its spacecraft. Some witnesses claim they saw the extraterrestrial astronaut attempting to break into a house during the turmoil, allowing a few people that were closer in those moments to take a better look at the alien being. The appearance of the extraterrestrial was depicted as small and gooey, with long arms and long fingers, and the fingers seemed to help him climb the tree easily. The event caused a massive reaction among the UFO community, so this doesn't sound like a typical gray, including UFO blogger Scott C. Waring, who adverted that the aliens seldom exit their spacecrafts. He also speculates that the extraterrestrial may have wanted to be seen by the humans, possibly to accustom them with the first ever sight of another child from the universe. Another
is
quote.
There,
go
is
ahead.
There any...
There is video on this, and I'll put a link in chat room. Unfortunately, the video is in another language that I do not understand, and there is no translation on the videos. I'm going to put a link up in chat so you guys can take a look at this.
Now, what did they say happened to the alien? Did it get back into its spacecraft and fly away?
Well, they said it climbed a tree to get back to its craft, so I assume it must have gotten in the craft, or they didn't see it after it got up the tree. So, yeah, apparently it went into a tree to get back into its craft.
See, I'd be interested to know if there was any police testimony, because love them or hate them, they are pretty good at determining and giving good reports on these situations. And if they're faking it and just having a laugh with the community, you can usually tell.
Well, I highly encourage all the listeners to give a look, because there's actually two news story videos in the article. And for the listeners, I can try to relay this URL for you as best as possible. It's www.ewao.com/a/residence-l-dorado-witness-presumed-ufo-crash-depict-alien-outcome. And that's the whole URL. So if you don't have the ability to go in the chat room, that's the whole URL. It'll get you to earthweareone.com.
And dude, you can just type El Dorado Crash Alien in Google. That's it. Bolivia.
See, Mark has to make everything so simple. But yeah, there are
the videos.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Two videos there. So yeah, I don't understand the language. But if you do
Spanish,
I think it's Spanish. It would make sense in Bolivia that they would speak Spanish. Obviously. But I wouldn't guarantee that.
Well, it sounds like a very interesting incident.
It does. I mean, there was a lot of commotion over it. There was several news agencies that covered it, and lots and lots of witnesses, it looks like.
Well, that's it. Ground reports are great. And I mean, this one has it all. So,
awful, awful fascinating.
I'm definitely going to watch those videos later. Probably shouldn't do that right now.
So, gosh, I don't know. Just that story alone, that is very different than any other UFO witnessing that I've heard of in a long, long time. The gooiness of the alien with the long fingers and stuff. That's definitely a different, being than I think we've heard described as of recent anywhere. Have you guys heard of anything to that extent before? I've heard of lots of extraterrestrial sightings. And I've heard of, reptilians, I've heard of mantis, I've heard of, things that are kind of short and brown, but I've never heard this gooey thing before. Have you guys?
Nope. I have never heard of any anything where they mention a gooiness to the actual being.
Yeah, not necessarily like descriptively, but I mean, there is the theory that UFOs and that are like organic organisms or something, or a sky worm, right, and things like that. It's so the gooey blob thing could still be related, although there aren't like descriptions as there are of greys and things. But
I'd like to see from that is a drawing by the children of the beings, or the being. It was just one. That would be.
There was, wasn't there, on that?
Was there on the video?
That one of the thumbnails was definitely of a drawing someone had done. So.
Yeah, but I don't know if that was actually related. You know how those sites are; they'll bring in images that aren't necessarily related to the article, just to give it more.
Well, they've kind of drawn something that looks a bit like a Simpsons character head, with it just looks like a normal human. Yeah.
Is it a gooey human?
Well, he's got kind of long feet.
Huh. Well, I see the one with the UFO crash, and it looks like an alien gray with, I don't know, a kind of weird body. But I don't think that's a drawing that the children made. That looks like a graphic artist. I don't know about that one.
Yeah, I'm going to watch these videos later and report back because that picture may be misleading.
Yeah, I think it is, but it's interesting.
But it's the ground reports that matter. It's not the videos and it's not the pictures. I mean, it's great that they did, but I personally believe you just listen to the people.
Yeah.
If they want to lie, they're going to lie, and maybe one or two people will. But if you say...
Yeah, but when you have that many people describing something, I mean, unless they had like a town meeting, you know, and said, okay, this is what we're going to say, and they all get together and corroborate a story beforehand, you know what I'm saying? It's kind of hard to have, you know, that many people witnessing something, sharing something similar and have it not be legit unless, you know, it was like pre-rehearsed. You know what I mean?
Definitely.
So
it's still baffling to this day. And yet it seems to happen. Well, now with this article, it's happened recently. But I mean, this has happened throughout history. You think about when that Australian thing happened where a UFO came down into the school. You know, 40 kids saw it, and many of them didn't want to speak about it for years after that. And it's happened then and previous to that. I mean, that was, you know, so many times, and yet you never quite get the answer. It always evades.
I think it gets swept under the rug, too.
But you're right. If so many people are witnessing the same thing, it would have to be a pretty... well-constructed hoax or whatever, you know, to get them all to say that.
Yeah, well, if you remember in 1942, they had the big massive sighting in Los Angeles with the Battle of L.A. with that UFO that was over Los Angeles that they fired missiles at it. You know, they had spotlights on it. There are photos of it, you know. And yet, you know, people are like, well, there's no evidence, you know. It's like, well, what is this? You know, what is this object that sat there and hovered over Los Angeles, you know, for hours in 1942 that they fired ground missiles at and it didn't damage it whatsoever? If it was a weather balloon, wouldn't those missiles have hurt it? You know, wouldn't the artillery have done something to it? So, and the other thing with that is, I mean... If whatever race was steering, maneuvering that craft was meaning to do any harm, don't you think it would have responded to being attacked? That in and of itself, that it just sat there while they fired artillery at it, it speaks volumes, I think. In most of the other instances, you know, when there are government-related sightings, it's usually, you know, when the craft are shutting down nuclear silos. I mean, it seems like they're almost like the parents of planet Earth saying, look, you know, you're grounded now because you're doing things. You're going to damage yourselves. You're going to kill not only yourselves, but you're going to affect the rest of us out here quite possibly. So I'm sorry, but we're going to have to ground you. We're turning off your missiles and you're not getting them back. It's like taking some kid's game away from them, you know? But seriously, though, I mean, I know it's a different analogy, but yeah.
They didn't stop us from Brexit, though.
No.
Come and say no Brexit for you.
Well, I don't think that was something that they felt, you know, was going to cause, you know, massive irreparable harm to the planet. I'm sure at the time when missiles were shut down that there was probably things going on that we did not know about, and there was a reason behind them shutting those missiles down. There were tensions going on that perhaps the general public was not aware of at the time.
Totally. Well, yeah, I believe the intervention has been there long before we have, and you know, it could go as far back as the very beginning of existence of anything, all we know.
So. Well, my ancestors certainly think so. So, you know, stories go way, way back to, you know, our earliest creation stories. So I tend to nod, you know, and say, if this legend, if these stories are so old that they're on cave walls, there must be some merit to it, you know?
Definitely. But why is it always so evasive?
That's a good question. I'm not sure. So
mystery.
I was just going to say
mystery is a healthy part of life.
Well, it is.
As you say, if it's been there since the dawn of time,
I don't think it's always been hidden and unknown. I think that's a modern thing.
The fluoride in the water, is it?
That and other things. I think the information that we get is, you know, a lot of information has been destroyed from previous civilizations. You know, when you think about the Spanish that invaded Mexico areas, you know, the Incas and the Mayan civilizations, a lot of their records were destroyed by the Spanish conquistadors. They didn't want them to have their old stories and things, and history had to be rewritten from that point on. This has happened, you know, around the world over time, where libraries get destroyed and information is lost for time. I'm hoping that, you know, the fabled Library of Alexandria that is believed to exist, and they keep saying this giant hall of records, you know, they think it's been found, you know, but we haven't seen anything of it yet. But I would love to see that resurface. I would love to see lost information coming back to people, you know, in whatever form it is. It's going to shock the heck out of us if, you know, we find this massive, mysterious chamber full of what we know must be records, but they're not in a way we can read because it's in the readable format of a technology that perhaps we don't currently have the ability to interpret, you know, like, you know, cavemen finding a cassette tape, you know, or something to that extent. You know, they wouldn't be able to tell what the information on that tape was, or a video, you know. The data might be in a form that we may not be able to read because we don't have the technology to read it.
But it's like you said earlier about parents grounding you in a way. I mean, what even makes you think that information is still there? How do we know it wasn't taken away as a sort of, you're not having this?
Well, now, a past life memory that I've actually had, I know that some records were taken away. I have this memory of, I believe, I'm not for certain, but I believe it was Atlantis, this memory, because I have this memory of being in something that looks kind of similar to our current flying saucers, but smaller, like a personal vehicle size. And I'm in it, and the top half of my body is like above it. So I'm only halfway in it. So I don't know how it's like a bouncer. I don't know, but it's a craft. It's a saucer shaped one, which I've seen lots of UFOs. I've never seen a saucer shaped one. But I'm in this little mini vehicle skidding across the ocean above it. And I'm racing to get to these archives that I have to save because the land is sinking into the water. And I've got to get to them in time to save them. And this is, I've had this. This has been there for the longest time. I equate it to Atlantis because it is a civilization that was very advanced, obviously, because I'm in a saucer in this memory. And there's information that's getting ready to be lost. Everything we know about Atlantis was that it was an advanced civilization that sunk into the water. I've had other visions that tell me that Atlantis didn't necessarily all sink into the water. There was something else that happened, but I'm not even going to go into that right now. But I have this memory. And I don't know that it was for sure Atlantis, but I do have a memory of maybe it's even, you know, this vision I had is a future life. Who knows? I don't know.
The God Machine. Did you see that?
No.
Did that come into it?
No. What is that?
Well, this theory that Atlanteans and the Thulians were maybe going to war or something. So, you know, the Atlanteans had their God creating machine and the Thulians had something else that I can't quite remember right now. Well, it's something along those lines.
A theory, another theory that is... Now, who presented that one? Do you know?
Yes, it was Indiana Jones and the Fate of Atlantis.
Oh, for goodness sakes.
Well, that was... No, I mean, this is a popular theory. I mean, this is... Okay. This is the Thule... I'm sure...
Well, yeah, I mean, the Crystal Skull one, I mean, did go along with ideas, you know, related to that. So I could see that. Yeah. I don't recall that, though.
Well, why do you believe Atlantis sank, then? What's your reasons behind that?
Cataclysm. There was war. There was destruction.
Well, who were they at war against? This is a complex story,
okay, guys, because what I saw, I had a vision, and I actually started writing it down at the time because I was sitting in my car waiting for someone when I got this. But there were two. Well, originally there was this one group, and they were known as the Council of Light. They were the beings that presided over Atlantis. They were the rulers of Atlantis. Okay. They were not human. They were not human. They were known as the Council of Light. They were benevolent. They were not from here as we know it, but they presided over the humans there, and they kind of, I guess, acted as their gods, you know, sort of. And they kind of helped them with all the technology and everything. But what started happening, and this kind of goes along with the Old Testament, with the angels that rebelled, was that certain members of the council started to get involved with human activity, and they started to become corrupt and want to acquire wealth and wanted to have relations with the human women, which goes along with the idea of the Bible where certain angels wanted to take human women as wives. Perhaps angels were these Council of Light. I don't know. Perhaps that's its interpretation. Maybe that's how it got interpreted. But what happened was some of the council members became corrupt. They started to go towards the more physical. And my understanding of these beings was that they weren't just not from here, but they were from another dimensional reality above ours because they were higher vibrational beings. So they were trying to help us raise our vibration. And some of them started to get bogged down with the human beings and get pulled down, and a disagreement, I guess, became because the people that weren't corrupted didn't want to see this happening, and they asked them to stop, and the ones that were corrupted started fighting against them. And this is what kind of started the war, so to speak, that destroyed everything. But in my vision, this is how the Illuminati actually started. The ones that are trying to control everything and bring this one world government to come to be are actually the corrupted ones. So there are actually, according to my vision, two separate Illuminatis. There are the original uncorrupted Council of Light members that are still trying to benevolently guide humanity into a better dimension, and they still exist. But there's also these others that are lower vibrational beings now because they pulled themselves down willingly to that vibration because they liked it. They liked the physical feelings of, you know, being with human women and just all the sorts of pleasures that the human body brought with it. And so this is what my vision was. This is what I've seen. I don't know, you know, maybe just completely, but this is what I saw. So there it is.
Yeah, that's cool, man. I'm trying to just look up the Thulians, because that does sound similar about this, you know, this internal war.
Huh.
Maybe led to the destruction and fall of Atlantis.
That's what I saw. I don't know anything about Thulians or anything. I didn't see names or anything, but I understood the different. I don't know how, but I understood that the vision of them was what started the whole mess that we're in right now. It's just kind of gone downhill since.
Yeah. How did this relate to the UFOs and aliens?
We were talking about Hall of Records and stuff, and then it got me into the past life memory.
Yeah.
That,
yeah, you know
how that goes.
That's absolutely fine. Like, so you were looking for these records, and I guess what you were saying, what we were talking about just before that is, well, I'd mentioned I'd said maybe they'd taken some of this information away. What was your point with the records that you seem to be in search of.
Oh, well, they were protected. That was the whole point, was to take them away to protect them from being destroyed.
Did it seem like information you were allowed to access or not?
Not now, but then, yes. I was in charge of it at the time, protecting it, but now, no. No access to that. Well, I suppose you could say I have some amount of access to the fact that I even remember this. But yeah. Other than that, no, it kind of reminds me of the one, like I've talked about, the woman that came to me when I was a little girl and told me I wasn't going to be able to remember any of what she told me until the time was right. So it's kind of like that, I guess. Things seep in, you know, slowly over time as they're supposed to, I guess. But you know, I think part of the reason that I understand that we reincarnate so many times is because of memories that I have of previous lives, and some that aren't even on this planet. But part of that's because of that in and of itself. There are other reasons, too. Like when I've spirit walked and I've gone outside of, you know, the physical existence that I'm in right now, and I've actually looked at the universes beneath me, and that's totally, you know, that's for another time.
Oh, I thought you were going to say that's totally a trip or something.
Well, it kind of is. I mean, a spirit walk is kind of a trip in and of itself, and shamans are actually able to induce trance states and go on journeys through rhythmic means, through different types of meditation, through music, drums, things like that, without chemical plant, I guess, helping out in that way. But that is one of the methods also. But obviously, in the day and age we live in, it's not possible. So, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, we have something else, actually. We're not going to get nearly in as much as I wanted to tonight, but we went off in some interesting directions, right? This kind of plays in because there's a story that I came across about a strange sound that's coming from the Caribbean Sea that can be heard from space. This is also from the Earth We Are One website. So every once in a while, scientists find some phenomena, you know, that caused them to reevaluate what we know about the world. Well, now they've discovered a strange sound coming from the Caribbean Sea, which produces an interaction that causes dramatic changes that alters Earth's gravity field. Now, this really goes beyond, because apparently it can be heard from space, but beyond that, it affects our gravity. I don't even understand. And I suppose they're kind of, you know, dumbfounded by this as well. So it turns out the Caribbean Sea produces a sound that can be heard from space. It's an A flat tone it produces, which is far too low for human ears to detect. The mystery sound was found after a study led by scientists from the University of Liverpool in the region found that the Caribbean behaves like a giant instrument through an unusual oscillation in the Earth's gravity field. Researchers noticed the strange phenomenon while analyzing activity in the area between 1958 and 2013. By examining sea levels and pressure readings from the bottom of the Caribbean Ocean, tide gauges, and satellite measurements of gravity, experts have found out that the area produces what they have called a Rossby whistle. The strange phenomenon occurs when a larger wave flowing westward interacts with the seafloor, and as the wave reaches the boundaries to the west, it dies out, but reappears on the eastern side of the basin. Scientists refer to this phenomena as the Rossby wormhole. Well, that is really, really weird. Goodness. I mean, that's I would call it a wormhole because it reappears on the other side. I don't even understand how that's even possible.
It says Caribbean Sea.
In the Caribbean Sea, yeah. However, this process can only be made possible by ways of a particular length or otherwise they cancel themselves out. So this so-called Rossby waves tend to reinforce themselves, producing an oscillation with a distinct period. During this interaction, water is known to pour in and out of the basin every 120 days. The dramatic change in mass alters the Earth's gravity field. This causes the Caribbean Sea whistle, which lets out an A-flat tone, which is below the audible range for humans, but is registered from space. There's a quote from Professor Chris Hughes that says, "We can compare the ocean activity in the Caribbean Sea to that of a whistle. When you blow into a whistle, the jet air becomes unstable and excites the resonant sound wave, which fits into the whistle cavity. Because the whistle is open, the sound radiates out so you can hear it. Similarly, an ocean current flowing through the Caribbean Sea becomes unstable and excites a resonance of a rather strange kind of ocean wave called the Rossby wave. Because of the Caribbean Sea being partly open, this causes an exchange of water with the rest of the ocean, which allows us to hear the resonance using gravity measurements."
Weird. But
it is.
Here is the sound. That's it.
Wow.
And it only lasts that little 2 or 3 seconds. And if I play any more of that, it goes into someone's YouTube video. But right. That's the noise.
That's about as much we can cool. get away with, too. That's awesome. Wow.
So it's like...
That is some creepy sci-fi sound and stuff, too. I mean, isn't it? Don't you expect to hear that, like, in a sci-fi movie? That sound?
Yeah.
I would totally expect to hear that in a sci-fi movie. That is weird, weird, weird. Now, I'm dumbfounded by the fact that it actually affects our magnetic field. That kind of scares me a little bit. I mean, is that really the only part of the world where the water can affect our, you know, if that area can affect our magnetic field, shouldn't it possibly happen in other areas? Or is there just something so special about that area that causes that? It's interesting.
Well, that's it. Well, we've got other, like, underwater phenomena like that. Like
the bloop.
That's a famous one.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to get that sound now, but I can't quite get it. But, I mean, that's, like, a random spot in the, I think it was the Pacific, maybe, or maybe the Atlantic side of sort of South America.
It's the Pacific, I believe. I believe it's the Pacific.
Yeah.
And it was heard for, like, 2,000 miles. 2,000 miles it could be heard.
Exactly. So we're talking, so actually Caribbean Sea is, you know, that sort of, that where I'm looking on the map is the sort of opposite side to where the bloop sound was heard.
Mm. And they have no explanation for the bloop. I mean, they can't say oscillating waves, this, that, and the other thing. They don't have that. They don't know what that is. That's just one of those unexplainable noises that I don't think there's ever been an explanation for. Have you ever? Either of you ever heard?
I've never heard of an explanation for it. I've heard of the phenomenon, the bloop sound, but I've never heard of an explanation for it.
There was a lot of weird things happening in 1997, I have to say, because that's when the bloop was recorded, was 1997. I remember that because that was the year my daughter was born. It was also the year that we saw the gold fluid sphere-like UFO at the drive-in. But there was, I think, several other things that happened in that year. So it was a very paranormal year, I guess you could say, 1997. I don't know. That's one of those things. But the bloop happened then, too, and just all kinds of weird stuff. I'm going to have to, like, pull together all of the weird events that happened in 1997 and, like, put together a show just about paranormal 1997 sometime, just to go over all the kind of weird stuff that happened. I wonder why things happen, you know, in kind of like just fluxes like that where, you know, you go a time.
Well, I told you.
Yeah.
We have our flaps. And they will come around, and we are due another one. It's like, I'm pretty sure they sort of happen in 10-year stints, because we had a big one in sort of 2000, 2099, 98. There was stuff there. And then the early 90s with Independence Day, that was, you know, there was stuff going on.
Well, now we got the new Independence Day out. Has anybody seen that yet? That came out today, right?
Yes, it was today. So, no, I haven't seen that yet.
Not seen it yet either, but I'm looking forward to it. I hope it's as good as the original. I absolutely loved the original. It was awesome.
It was. No Will Smith, but...
No.
Shall we listen to the bloop quickly?
Yes,
yeah. Creative Commons.
Definitely. Kind of sounds like when you're swimming.
Yeah.
Let
so
out some
crazy.
Air. That's weird.
But that's some... Exactly. I mean, that little bloop is some...
But it was
big,
so
big
loud.
Big shifting
that it was
heard, noise thing.
Yeah, I mean, it was heard 2,000 miles away, you know?
I think that inside they speed it up, don't they? That might be sped
yeah,
up.
Yeah, it like was it was much slower. Yeah, it was supposed to take place over a long
time. That makes
which
it even...
Makes you, it makes it even more unusual, doesn't it? Did we lose you, Marky?
Oh, sorry. Yeah,
there
I was...
Okay.
Yeah, no, I was. Yeah, that makes it stranger, because then in reality, it was sort of going... very slowly like that. So yeah, what the heck.
So we got 5 minutes left, actually more like three. Really quick, I want to touch on a story that I found about a scientist who on his deathbed apparently made a lot of confessions about Area 51 and aliens and stuff. A recording has been released of the late U.S. scientist Boyd Bushman, who worked at a secret base of the United States Air Force. At that secret base, alien technology was developed and adapted for human use. According to Boyd, numerous alien bodies were studied at the facility as well. In the video recorded shortly before his death, the Lockheed Martin scientist shows images of alien bodies, which according to him were taken with disposable cameras at Area 51. A secret base, of course, everybody knows, of the Air Force in the state of Nevada in the desert. Even though some of the details in the biography of Bushman may seem controversial, according to British tabloid Metro, Bushman was an important researcher in Aerospace Corporation of Lockheed Martin and had highly classified patents. I do not doubt that whatsoever. I've told you guys about my mother-in-law who had very high clearance in the Pentagon, which was at the time the War Department. And, you know, actually this, oh, this is very interesting. Yeah, this actually does look this. There's pictures. Let me put this in chat real quick of this alien extraterrestrial being. It does look like what she described to me that she saw in the hangar at White Sands, New Mexico after the Roswell crash. So, yeah, as for extraterrestrial crafts, we have United States citizens who work 24 hours a day studying UFOs and alien technology, according to this man. We're trying to understand what we need to. Bushman confesses confessions were recorded on video. They're dotted with images of beings with humanoid bodies. Two groups of alien beings are studied at Area 51, but there are also aliens who work in cooperation with humans. They go on to talk about what Area 51 is. There is a video at the link. According to Bushman, the alien technology is very advanced. These beings can travel at speeds much faster than light, and most of them come from planets that are located around 68 light years away from Earth. Bushman states that the aliens working at Area 51 are around 1.5 meters tall. They have fingers and toes like humans, but can live much longer than humans. These extraterrestrial beings are able to communicate via telepathy. Now, that's interesting because I've heard a lot of people say that they were when they have experiences firsthand, you know, first encounter, close encounter experiences and abduction experiences that they communicated with them telepathically. So this goes in line with what abductees have said and have reported. So that makes perfect sense. Yeah, we are coming down to the end of the show. So this has been kind of, we've been all over. We've been all over the Illuminati tonight. We've been all over aliens, UFO sightings, which is pretty per normal for us, isn't it, guys? I think
I would say so.
Yeah, yeah. It's kind of our norm. I mean, the anomalous is normal for us, right?
There's always something to learn. What did we learn tonight? We learned aliens are gooey, maybe.
Yeah, they're possibly gooey.
Don't be a holistic doctor.
Yeah.
Alien probe is inbound for 2017.
Mm-hmm.
And that the sea makes some very strange noises once in a while.
And can affect our magnetic field, which is a little scary in and of itself. So, yeah, everybody, thank you for listening tonight. Thank you, Marky and Melina, for being with us. And also thank you for Patrick to calling in. And you guys want to check out the website. It's anomalousrealities.com. Let me know what you think of the new website design, because it's a work in progress, and I could certainly use the opinions. And don't forget to visit us on Facebook. It's facebook.com/anomalousrealities. Good evening, everyone.
Good night.
Night.